الآخرين سيدنا محمد وصحبه أجمعين. Welcome again, my dear brothers and sisters. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless our meeting. And we'll continue, inshallah, our study for some of the verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. And last week, we finished ayat number 40 and 41. And today, inshallah, we'll continue from 42. So we'll start with our PowerPoint presentation. So, طيب this is سورة البقرة verse number 42. Allah سبحانه وتعالى saying in this ayah, as we said before or last week, this ayat is addressing, started by addressing the children of Israel, Banu Israel. Remember, ayah number 40 said, Ya Bani Israel, اذكروا نعمتي التي أنعمت عليكم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started these verses by saying, O children of Israel. So still here, the speech is addressing the children of Israel, the Jew. So we already last week, we explained two verses, and today this is continuous for the same subject. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, وَلَا تَلْبِسُوا الْحَقَّ بِالْبَاطِلِ وَتَكْتُمُوا الْحَقَّ وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. And do not mix the truth with a falsehood, or conceal the truth while you know it. Some people, and when it said this, that either you conceal the truth, you cover the truth, you didn't tell it, or you say the truth mixed with some lies or fabrication, or switching the meaning so it will not be clear for the one who hear it. So let's go to this verse one by one. طيب and do not mix. Mixing, when you mix two matters together, you know, like when you mix two, and this we use it for physical matters. See, don't mix milk with tea, with coffee, with mixing. And you know always the outcome of any mixing, it will not be exactly as the same of the thing that was used. So it will not be tea, or it will not be milk. It will be, you know, tea with milk. So it's different, even the color and the taste. This is for something that physical that we use. But some people, they don't realize, or they may not imagine that mixing sometimes it's come also in what? In ideas and speech. When people, they try to misguide or to slip away from the truth, they cannot cover it all. And at the same time, they don't want to tell it. So they give general statement, mixing some of the truth with some of the imaginations, or you know, extra words. So the outcome, it will be different. The truth will not be clear. The truth, it won't be clear. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned here. Don't mix what is right with anything which is false. And this, as you know, it's called tashbih or shubha. Shubha means that you give something, it looks like, you know, something different from it is original form or original nation. How do they do this? I mean, the Jew, and why the Quran is addressing them? Because, you know, sometimes they cannot deny that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is messenger from Allah Azza wa Jal, and from a prophet from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they tell the people, yes, well, and this is, by the way, these days, it's become increasing among some of the Western thinkers, you know, some of the scholars in the West. I hear some speech for some American, some European philosopher, when they talk about Islam and they talk about Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, they said, yes, Muhammad is a prophet, but he is for the Arabs own, is not for everyone. So they are mixing here. They want to say, yes, we acknowledge that he's a prophet, but he's not for everyone. It's not for us. And this is what the Jew, they used to do there. They said he is just a prophet of the Arabs. So they're mixing here. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the word truth again by saying, and don't conceal the truth. The translation said, or conceal the truth. But it said in the ayah, wala, and don't conceal the truth. Don't cover the truth. Don't hide it. The truth should be clear. He saw here. Twice the Quran here mentioned the word truth. Don't mix it with something false so to not be clear, and don't hide it. Which means that you should mention the truth as it is. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, while you know the truth, why should you conceal it? Why should you hide it? Why should not tell it clearly for the people? And you know, here, why the Quran said, while you know? Because the Jew and the Christian, those, the people of the book, in fact, they know about the coming of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They know about the revelation of the Quran. The Quran was mentioned in their books. Yeah, the advent of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was mentioned in their books. Their scholars, their knowledgeable people, they know even the description, full description of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned other ayat, يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاءَ. Those who were given the books before, they know about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more the same way that they know their own children. Everyone knows his, nobody knows your child more than you. And the Quran gives this example in other ayat, that they know about Muhammad, or they know the description of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, same as they know their own children. So they know it, but they hide it. And this here, you see that the conceal of the truth for what? So the people will not discover it. And sometimes the person maybe reached the truth, but he think it is too late for him, because he's already stuck with this worldly gain, worldly life. And this is why it's very important for the person, whenever he finds the truth, he should accept it. Now let's take what can we learn from this verse. The first thing that we learn is that one should say the truth clearly and never mix it with the false by repeating misleading statements and ideas. It is very important, my dear brothers, Islam always teach us to be straightforward, no confusion in our speech, no misleading in our statements or talk, no mixing between what is right and wrong, no haze or position. It's very clear. And this is, it is always in all matters. The Muslim should be very, very careful to care about telling the truth. And it is must, as it said, must, it is must on the person to say the truth, because he said, ولا تلبس الحق بالباطل. Don't ever. And this is like forbidding a person or the one from mixing the truth with the false. Like, you know, nowadays you will find many people, unfortunately, among Muslims, they may say general statement because they don't want to say the truth. They think if they say the truth, other side will not accept it. Like, for example, nowadays, because many of this movement, feminist movement, and talking about the rights of women, so some people, you know, even among da'iyah, they hesitate to tell what the position or, you know, the difference between man and woman in Islam. So they say, no, there's no difference between man and woman in Islam. This statement is confusing. And this contradicts with what? With the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَيْسَ الذَّكَرُ كَالْأُنْثَى Surah Ali Imran. The female is not like the male. It's very clearly state, very clear statement. That doesn't mean that, you know, one side or one gender is more preferred than the others. You know, they are equal in rights. But also there is different differences between the male and the female because of their nature. You cannot make the male like the female or the female like the male, man like woman or woman like a man. But every one of them, he has certain you know, character, which is he was preferred with it. So everyone, and this does not affect their rights. Every side has in Islam the rights that fit his nature and her nature. Like, for example, spending. One of the right, it is the right on man for whom? For the woman. Why? Because the man, the one who should work, the man, the one who should strive for the safety and the care, you know, and the goodness of his family. So he should spend. It's not must in woman to work or to go outside to have income to take care of the family. She has, at the other side, she has a noble task, more important than this, which is taking care of raising a human being, raising these children, taking care of them when they are little babies. So look, always we should remember that equality is different than sameness. So we don't look at men and women as they are the same, but they are equal when it's come to rights and obligation. But even in, when we talk about equality in right and obligation, that doesn't mean exactly the right of the man exactly the same like the right of the woman, or the right of the woman same like the right of the man. Why? Because every side of them, every one of them, he needs certain matters which is, will be an obligation on the other side. So I hope this is very clear. So this is one example that is common nowadays. So the Muslim should be very clear when he's telling the statement. Another example of confusing statement that some Muslim they may say when they meet non-Muslim like Jew or Christian, they say, we are all believers. He said, we are all believers. We believe in the same God. This confusing statement also. When you say to the one Christian who say and believe that Jesus Christ is God or Son of God, and you tell him that we are all Muslim and Christian are believers and we believe in the same God, that's not correct. You should be very clear by saying the original, the teaching of Jesus Christ, alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, see, the revelation that was revealed to Isa alayhi salam from the same God that revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the religion of Isa alayhi salam is this Islam, is the same like, you know, the teaching of Islam. But nowadays I cannot say that me and you, we are believing in the same God. Because you are not even believe in the same God that Jesus Christ himself taught the people to follow or to worship. He called you to believe in oneness of God. And now you are taking him as God or son of God. So these are an example, you know, of some of the heathenist, you know, statement. Some Muslim, unfortunately, he think that when you say this word, it try to attract the heart of the other side. Be very clear and very nice way, but should be direct. No confusion. So this is one example also of confusion or mixing the truth and false. And the Muslim should be very clear, especially when you are in the field of da'wah. In the field of da'wah. Don't hide anything. Yes, maybe you delay explaining certain things to other time. No problem with this. It's not must, you know, that you give the whole teaching at once from the beginning. In fact, gradually. And this is the right way for da'wah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he sent Mu'ad ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu to call the people of the book in Yemen, what he said to him? He didn't say to him, go there and call him to Allah and they should worship Allah and they should make prayer and fasting. No. Look at the teaching of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, إِنَّكَ تَأْتِي قَوْمًا أَهْلَ كِتَابٍ. You will come to a group of people who are, you know, believing in the scriptures. فَلْيَكُنْ أَوَّلَ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ. Look at this. فَلْيَكُنْ. Therefore, make sure that the first thing that you call them to believe is to believe in the oneness of God. فَإِنْهُمْ أَطَاعُوا. Then if they accept this, then tell them that they should pray. So this is, it's okay. It's okay to delay parts of the knowledge to the right time because it's based on the first one. But if somebody asks you a question clearly, then you should answer it clearly and no mixing. طيب. There is only either true and false and nothing between. So this is a point that we learn from this ayah. So it is either right or wrong. Is it halal or haram? There's nothing between. There is nothing between. Either halal or haram. So the Muslim should be very careful about this. Now. Right. So I think this is very clear. So let's go to the next one. The next ayah. I think there's someone. It is forbidden. I think this is where the Torah it is explained. Yeah. As I said, if a person asks about certain point, you should make it clear for him and do not delay, but you should tell it in the right and the correct way. One example for this. You know, it's not necessary if a man come to say Shahada, he said, I want to be a Muslim, to tell him that, you know, okay, Islam to like this. And he said, I want to say La ilaha illallah, I want to become Muslim. What should you tell him? Okay, since he entered Islam, accept Islam. But you should not tell him from the beginning, look, but you have to go and have circumcision. You don't have to tell him this. But if he asked you, and he said, well, do I have to go to, you know, I'm not circumcised, should I go and have some circumcision in the hospital before I become Muslim? Now we tell him the truth. First of all, circumcision is not must. Here, it's not must. Tell him it is preferred, it is good, it is. So you tell him the truth about circumcision. But not the first thing that when somebody comes to say Islam, and I noticed that some brothers, whenever somebody, you know, say la ilaha illallah, the next day they take him to the hospital for circumcision. So it's okay to, as I said, delay the truth if it is طيب. Now let's go to the next ayah, and this is a very important one, and all the Quran is important. وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَارْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ. Now there are three commands here. And establish prayer. Look, he said aqim. Aqim from qama. Stand. Establish prayer. And give zakah. This is the second one. And bow with those who bow. This, the last command, confirmed the first command. Because bowing only where, you know, when you're praying. When the salah. It's not like sujood. The sujood you can make sujood outside the salah. But the bowing as ibadah, as an act of worship, only in the salah. Sujood, there is sujood at tilawa, when you are reciting the Quran, and then come there is ayat of sajda, you make sujood. You are not in salah, outside the salah. Sujood is shukr. Sometimes you get good news, you want to show, to praise Allah Azza wa Jal, to be thankful for him. So you prostrate to make sujood. But bowing only in the salah. طيب. Establish. He didn't say pray. He didn't say pray. He said establish prayer. And this is what they call it, iqamatu salah, which means that you should, when established, that means you build your prayer. Taking care of what? Of the arkan, of the wajibat, of the shurut. You should first of all make sure that you meet the conditions, the preconditions for the salah. This is one of the iqamat al-salah. Then you make sure that you do the arkan, which is the pillars of the salah. And then you should take good care of the obligation. We got to react to salah. And this is my dear brothers, why it is very important for the Muslim to know the difference between the conditions of salah, the obligatory acts of salah, and the arkan of salah. Unfortunately now, many Muslims, they born even as Muslim, they grow as a Muslim, they pray all the time in the masjid, but they don't know the difference between the rukun and the wajib. What is pillar and what is must obligation. And this is very important. Why? Because if a person make mistake, he know how to deal with it. As we mentioned, you know, in other classes, when we talk about sujood as-sahu. And then, you know, establishing the salah, that's mean also taking care of the time. And do it with khushu'. And do it with jama'ah for men, if they are resident. And they said, give the zakah. Wa'atu zakah. Ati, that's mean to give. And here, in the salah, didn't mention, by the way, salatul nafila or salatul farah. He said, establish prayer. He didn't mention obligatory prayer. Therefore, to establish a prayer, meeting its conditions, its of pillars, its khushu' should be done in all. In salatul fariida and salatul nafila. And compulsory prayer and optional prayer. Oh, this is salah in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we talk about the zakah here, and give zakah, this in command for the obligatory zakah. وآتوا الزكاة. This obligatory زكاة. And we know that the زكاة should be for certain group or certain category. It's not should be given to anyone. And this the recipient of صلاة of زكاة were mentioned in Surah At-Tawbah, Surah number 9. And should be given to a Muslim, either poor, needy, traveler that he lost his money, and a person in debt, and others. There are eight category who receive the salah, the zakah. So give the zakah and don't hide it, don't take it, don't delay it of its time. So when we said about zakah, this is al-zakat al-makhsusa, which is mean this is the command. Beside this, sometimes the Quran said, وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. This is general, more general. Why? And for whatever we provide them, they spend. And this spending, including the obligatory zakah, and also including the sadaqat, which is optional sadaqah. That's something that you give. And then he said, and bow with those who bow. And the ulama concluded from this that bowing is a symbol for the salah, as I mentioned before, because bowing is only in salah, not in any other situation, not like sujood. And he said, with those who bow. So some ulama, they took from this verse that salatul jama'ah is must. Salatul jama'ah is must. So it is very, very clear from this ayah that one should pray with others and not alone if it is obligatory prayer. So from this, my dear brothers, and other verses and evidences in the Quran and the Sunnah, we know that Salatul Jama'ah is must. You will find some people, they will tell you, no, Salatul Jama'ah, it's okay to pray at home, but if you pray at masjid, it is more extra reward, but it's not must. This ayah showed that it is must. This is command, and say, do it with others, not by your own. So we notice here that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in many ayat, many verses in the Quran, combined between these two arkan, salah and zakah. We know that salah is the second pillar of Islam and zakah is the third pillar of Islam, because the first pillar. And they always come together. But the salah is more mentioned, more than the zakah. Because always the zakah, when it's mentioned, it's come with the salah. But not always the salah, when it's come with zakah. An example, for this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 83, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَأَتُوا الزَّكَاةَ, and establish prayer and give the zakah. Also in Surah An-Nisa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said the same verse, وَاقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ. In Surah Maryam, mentioned about Ismail alayhi salam, وَكَانَ يَأْمُرُ أَهْلَهُ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ. Surah Maryam, verse number 55. He used to command his family of establishing prayer and doing zakah. And there are many of the ayat in the Quran, but in salah it's come sometimes alone, like for example in Surah Al-A'raf, verse number 72, Allah said, وَأَنْ أَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَاتَّقُوهُ, establish prayer and fear him. There's no mention for the zakah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Yunus, وَأَقِيمُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said also in Surah Ar-Rum, وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَبَشِّرِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Zakah was not mentioned. وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَلَا تَكُونُوا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. This is in Surah Ar-Rum. So there are, this to show you that salah is more important than the zakah. In fact, the ulama of Islam unanimously agree that leaving the salah or abandoning the salah make the person get out of the fold of Islam. But no mention for the one who doesn't give zakah. The one who doesn't give the son is still a Muslim, but he will be punished for this. But the one who don't pray, this is what the Prophet ﷺ said, العهد الذي بيننا وبينهم الصلاة فمن تركها فقد كفر. The difference between us and them, I mean the disbelievers, is what? Salah. Whoever abandoned the Salah, then he is disbelieved. So this is also another difference between the Salah and Zakah. So we learn from this some of the lesson that we learn from this. Salah with bowing and prostrating was prescribed to previous patients. There is difference between some ulama. They said the salah of the Jew, it doesn't have bowing. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in this verse, bowing to tell them that you should follow the same example of the salah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which has bowing, because in their salah there is no bowing. Other ulama, they understood from this that previous nations, exactly the same. They have salah with bowing and prostration, same as our salah. And they support this with what was mentioned in Surah Maryam, وَارْكَعِي مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ. That means bowing. So anyway, this is very important to show that the salah with bowing and prostration was prescribed to nations before us. طيب. Also, we learn from this the zakah also that was mentioned and described for them. We learn also from this that this verse is proof obligation of congregation prayers, as I mentioned the explanation. When he said, وَارْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ, that means when you pray with others. And we say, mentioning the ruku' was a symbol for the salah, because the ruku' is only in salah and not in any other situation. طيب. More of this also, we learn that standing, because establish and stand, aqama, it's come as stand and as establish, show that praying while a person is standing is must. And it is rukun, which means that the person who pray while he is sitting, while he is able to stand, his salah is not valid in the obligatory salah, the compulsory salah, the five salah. But as for the optional salah, it is okay, accepted, but with half of the reward, half of the Ajr, only 50% of the reward of the salah he will get. But for the compulsory salah, a person, if he can stand, then he is not excused to pray while he is sitting. Also, we learn here that standing is significant in the salah, because the time of standing is more longer in time than other parts of the salah, like sitting, like prostrating, you know, it's not the same, like ruku'. And the other point is, in standing also, recitation of the Quran, which is the best part of the salah, the best dhikr in the salah, that when you either recite it yourself or you listen to the imam who is reciting the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So standing is the best position of salah here. Why? Because here you are standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and listen to his his verses. Also, some ulama, they said this is also indication that Muslim, when they pray, they should straight their lines, because you cannot pray with others, وَارْكَعْ مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ, while they are, while you are bowing, some are in front and some in the back, but they should be in the same line. So some of the ulama, they took from this verse also one benefit or one lesson. They said this is an indication that straightening the lines in صلاة الجماعة is must. Here also some ulama they said this to show you that الركوع is more preferable in صلاة. الركوع is more preferable, I mean the best position. We know that there are other hadith which mention that the sujood is one of the best position because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said وأقرب ما يكون العبد إلى ربه في السجود. You are more near to Allah سبحانه وتعالى when you are at the position of sujood. So you can ask him, you can pray for him. Besides, some ulama they said that the sujood is more preferable. Why? Because sujood cannot be done except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the one who prostrate for anybody else, he will be disbeliever or mushrik. While bowing, maybe in some traditions, like the Japanese and some cultures, they may say, you know, they lower their head or their back a little bit to show respect. So this is some of the point. Right. So there are, that doesn't mean the salah, I mean the ruku' is better than the sujood, or the sujood is better than the ruku'. This depends, as we say, in the situation. In the situation. So some ulama, they said, the sujood is more preferred because it has come in other situation. Sujood, as I mentioned before, sujood al-shukr, sujood al-tilawa, all these are come as part of this. طيب. Also, as we mentioned here, when he said, وَرْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ, do this together, to show the importance of working with others. Always Islam emphasizes the importance of unity and working together. Not individual, individual that you work by himself. The best work that you do is when you are cooperating with others as a team, as a team, or this is what they call it, team working. So the ulama, some ulama said, this to show you the virtue of working with other in worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also in all matter, and the Muslim should not be just all by himself. And this was mentioned based on the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which was reported by Sunan Abi Dawood, and was narrated by Abi Ubay ibn Ka'b, when he said, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إن صلاة الرجل مع الرجل أزكى من صلاته وحده وصلاته مع الرجلين أزكى من صلاته مع الرجل وما كثر فهو أحب إلى الله. The meaning of the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ is saying, the prayer of one man with another man is better than his praying by himself. And praying by two men is better than praying with one man. So the more the group, the best or the better is the salah. And this is why, as we said, Salatul Jama'ah is in the view of the most vast majority of the Muslim ulama is must and is not sunnah, as some people they say. It is must, and there are many hadith which show the importance of this Jama'ah, that even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned in one hadith that he was about to call for the salah, and when the iqamah is done, he will go to some people, some men who are staying at their home, and they don't join the prayer to burn their homes. This is just a matter of warning. This is to show you how much it is very important to for Salat al-Jama'ah. Now let's go to the next verse. أتأمرون الناس بالبر وتنسون أنفسكم وأنتم تتلون الكتاب أفلا تعقلون. Do you order righteousness of the people and forget yourselves while you recite the scripture, then will you not reason? Don't think. Right. When it said, do you order righteousness of the people? It is very important for the Muslim, the believer, always to guide others and to command them, if they are under his responsibility, to do righteousness and to do what is good. And when we say righteousness and good, my dear brothers and sisters, it's not what we think it is right or wrong, but what was mentioned in the teaching of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that it is good. It is not a matter of our taste to say this is good or not good. It is a matter if this was considered in the Sharia as good or not, right or not. So we always, our standard is what was mentioned in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this here, when said, do you order righteousness of the people and forget yourself? This is not a question that waiting for answer. He said, no or yes. No, no. This is, isn't shame on you? Isn't shame in you that you tell people to do good and you forget yourself? You don't do it yourself. So this is the concept. This is called it in Arabic, su'al inkari. Inkari, that means this is should not happen. This should not happen. That you tell people to do good and you don't know, you don't do it yourself, or you do the opposite. While recite the scripture, more than this, you do this while you know the truth, you know the knowledge, you have a knowledge of the scriptures, the teaching that was come to you. With all this knowledge, you tell people to follow, and then you yourself, you don't do it. So this sometimes happened, especially by the Jew, even during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You remember the story of the young boy when he was sick and was almost dying, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to visit him, and we mentioned this story before. And then he was a Jew and he was dying. And the Prophet ﷺ told him, say la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Believe in Allah. And the child looked at his father, and his father told him very clearly, obey Abu al-Qasim, obey Muhammad ﷺ. So he said a shahada. But the father didn't do it. So he commanded his child, because he loved his child maybe more than himself, because you know that this is the truth, but he didn't do it. So this is the way they use to do, like, you know, when they come to Medina. In the Medina, why, you know, that one of the reasons why the people of Medina believe in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the Jew used to tell them before the coming of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Medina that they are waiting for a prophet who will come very soon. And then when he come and they follow him, and then they will kill them. They will kill those pagans. So when the Prophet ﷺ came, what happened? Those Arabs believed in him. And those tribes who used to tell him that he will follow him, they didn't. And they know that it is the truth from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? As I said before, because they exchange very low price of this dunya, like position or wealth or whatever, you know, in exchange for the hereafter. طيب. And then Allah said, أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Don't you have a mind to think about? Don't be wise. How come this happened from you? This is inkari and tawbiq. طيب. The person always, you know, remember that he should set an example by himself. And this, my dear brothers and sisters, the best way for da'wah. The best way for da'wah is to give the example of Islam in your behavior, in your life, in the way that you deal with people. Because some people now, they make da'wah. That's good. Great. And they ask him, believe in Allah, believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's great. But when they look at his behavior, his character, his akhlaq, it will not call people to follow him. So sometimes he be a reason to push people away from Islam and the way that he's acting. And we know that the knowledge will be testify for you or against you. Allah Azza wa Jal here condemn them because they have knowledge of the scripture, but they don't apply it in their life. They don't apply it. They don't follow it. So the person, when he has knowledge, he should be the first one who acting according to this knowledge. And we know that whenever you practice what you learn, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless your knowledge, bless your deed, bless your conduct and deeds and action, and increase you in the knowledge. Always as because you practice what you learn. And we know that the person who was blessed by Allah Azza wa Jal with wisdom and mind and knowledge should appreciate this and he should follow his intelligence instead of following his desire. Many people nowadays, they know the truth, but they don't follow it because they love their desire. Some of them, they know that Islam is the truth, but because his wife is not a Muslim and he's afraid that if he embraces Islam, she will leave him. He may not accept Islam. So where is the reasoning in this? Where is the wisdom in this? So it is very important to understand these matters in full and in deep. Right. Let's go to some of the lessons as, you know, conclusion from this. Condemn those who command good, but they don't practice it or do it themselves. This is very important. And there is warning from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was mentioned in the hadith, that at the day of judgment, it will be brought a man or a person, and he will throw in the hell, and the people of the hell, they look at him and they said, "You used to command us to pray and do good, and so how come you are with us here in the hell? We didn't follow, we didn't listen to you. We regret that we didn't listen to you. But now you are with us." He said, "I used to tell you do this, but I don't do it myself." So it's very, very, very dangerous for the person that he should, he command others with goodness and forget himself. Now, here an argument that may come up. And then this, the shaitan will work in this, in our da'wah, in our activities, or in our effort to make da'wah. They said, then you should not call people to good unless you are perfect. How come you call people not to do certain thing and you do it? And this is from the shaitan. So how can we try to make compromise or to come to solution for this? Here it's come, the most important is what? The intention of the person. A person who wants and he is sincere intend to pray in the masjid, always. But sometimes he doesn't pray. Maybe he's getting lazy or tired, or maybe he was busy for himself. And the shaitani will tell him, "How come you tell people to go to the masjid and you'll pray at home here?" If the person is, his intention is to pray in the salah and masjid and you go always, then this will not affect you. Why? Because your attention, your heart is right, calling to the salah. But the problem with the people who say, okay, he may be, and there are some people like this, they kick their kids, children from home, they say, go to the masjid, go to the masjid. And when they go, and then he pray at home without no reason and doesn't know the masjid, doesn't go to the masjid. This is what is considered as shame on him, that he command him doing this, but he doesn't do it. A person who will tell people to give zakah, give money, help those, and he has enough money to spend, but he doesn't give. This is also, but if he is willing to spend, and he has good intention to spend, sometimes he do and sometimes done for other reason. So it is all go back to what's in your heart. So what we say here, that it is shameful on a person to command something, but he doesn't do it. Or command some people or advise not to come or do certain matters, but he do it. Like, for example, he said, don't drink alcohol. This is haram. Don't go to that place. It is forbidden because there are, you know, you may drink like bar or like disco or all these places. But one time, for example, because at a point of a weakness in certain situation, he was there or he went there or he did this. We say this is a mistake. He committed sin. He will retain, ask forgiveness. No problem for this. That doesn't make him stop not, you know, commanding people not to do this evil act. So I hope this is very clear. So don't take this as excuse and say, I will not command people. I will not tell people what to do. I will not forbid them from not doing wrong things because I didn't do it yet or I do it. This is not the right way. And I hope what I explain is enough. طيب. Also here to see that when the person, people of knowledge, like scholars and teachers, should give the best example of applying what they teach in their life. This is very important for all of us, as I made very, very clear in this, explanation. طيب. The one who commands good but don't do it, or forbid evil and don't do it himself, is following the way of the, because this is what they did, as we mentioned, you know, in the example of the father of that child. طيب. I think we already, it's already 12:22. طيب. واستعينوا بالصبر والصلاة وإنها لكبيرة إلا على الخاشعين. And seek help through patience and prayer. And indeed, it is difficult except for those humbly submissive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَاسْتَعِينُوا, seek help. الاستعانة, or seeking help, that you get support from a source, and this source, either a person, either a certain action, a practice certain way. And here the help was linked with what? With patience. Now, how come patience help? Because, you know, my dear brothers and sisters, we need patience. We need patience. We need patience to do our ibadah. We need patience to stay away from whatever Allah Azza wa Jal make forbidden. And we need patience also to be patient at the time of calamity and hard time. This is the three situation when the Muslim, the believer, need to be patient. الصبر على طاعة الله, الصبر عن معصية الله, الصبر عن على أقدار الله. What does this mean? الصبر على طاعة الله. To obey Allah Azza wa Jalla, you need to be patient. To wake up and go to the masjid, or to fast the whole day, or to go to Hajj, or to Umrah, or to isolate yourself and open the Mus'haf and recite the Quran every day, at least one juzu. This needs patience. The one doesn't patience cannot achieve any work, anything, anything, even in our worldly life here. We cannot achieve it without patience. If the student doesn't have patience, he go to the school, he do the homework, he study hard, will not achieve anything. So the same thing for the believer. So to obey Allah, you need to be patient. وصبر عن معصية الله. You know, our self also, our desire, push us to practice certain things which is haram. Looking at women, for example, for men, or the opposite, women looking at men, you know, in a way. Or, for example, dealing with riba, especially these days, dealing with riba or interest, try to increase our money in a lawful way. If the person doesn't have patience, he will not do it. Stay away from whatever Allah forbid. Need patience. The same thing also for whatever happened to us. You know, this life is not always, you know, you are relaxed. It is the nature of life that we have hardship and difficulties in different ways. The person may be full sick. The person may lose some of his loved one. Some die, you know. May lose job or whatever. So we need to be patient, because if the person doesn't have patience and he feel that since this was planned by Allah and he's believing Allah, he should have good thought about Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed this for him. For sure there is wisdom and for sure there is goodness for him. So he accepted. He accepted. Happily, because why? Because they said, this is the what Allah Azza wa Jal planned for me. And they love it because Allah wanted. And this is why, my dear brothers and sisters, you see that, alhamdulillah, among Muslim, in many Muslim communities, the rate of committing suicide is very low. If you compare it to other nations or other communities, why? Because the Muslim always have trust in Allah Azza wa Jal. And be patient. But a disbeliever, if his wife or loved one left him alone, he may kill himself. If he was working in good position and then something happened and they fire him from his job, he may kill himself. Why? Because they don't have hope. They don't have trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't have patience. So, and then I said, and prayer. And prayer. Prayer is one of the best source for patience. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam always, whenever he is in difficulty and hardship, he turned to salah. At the day of Badr, the battle of Badr, before the fighting, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stand in prayer and making supplication to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whenever at night, whenever there's any trouble facing, he will say to